Situations in your life require the droplets of forgiveness to become a deluge, then a flood of restoration and reconciliation.
South African journalist and novelist Margie Oxford speaks of how people, particularly women, who have undergone trauma, glue themselves back together. They become whole, but you still see the scars and cracks. What brokenness do you experience in yourself that needs God's divine healing?
Tea and sympathy is an idiom that has its origins from the play of the same name by Robert Anderson. It is popularly seen as meaning the offering of care and hospitality to someone who is troubled. What troubles are you carrying that might benefit from a moment to sit and dwell in the generous hospitality of God for some tea and sympathy?
By which disease passes into health, age into youth, death into life. Without proper care for it, we have no community. Because without proper care for it, we have no life. In what ways have you failed to care for the earth?
Well, we've been following the adventures of Jane. What a character. Nothing new under the sun. The patriarchs and the matriarchs of the Hebrew people had some stories. We found Isaac going to find Rebecca. And then within Rebecca's womb, Esau and Jacob are rescued. Siblings and rivals from the very beginning of conflict. And then Jacob takes a wife, Rachel. So we hear the story today of Joseph, Rachel's son and favorite child, who's gone off to Egypt. So the narrative of how the Hebrew people came from Canaan down to Egypt is background before we go into the birth of Moses next week. Hear these words from Genesis chapter 45. Joseph has his brothers have come down to get food because there's a famine in their land. Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And Joseph wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it. And the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother, Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me here before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth, and to keep alive for the many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. God has made me a father to the Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks and your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come into poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt, and that all you have seen here. Hurry and bring my father down here." Then Joseph fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept with them, and after that, his brothers talked with him. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. number of you am an introvert. If you're not an introvert, and I know we do have a few, you recognize me. You understand, maybe not deeply, it's probably perplexing, that I need space. I need time that's quiet, that's not a lot of input, so that I can get back in the fray. And yet I thrive on being in faith for you. So it's an interesting juggling act. So in my short story this week, I went to Davenport's piano bar. It's a cabaret. Jim and I have been there a number of times, and we were there on Thursday to see a friend who was doing a show there. She's an accomplished singer, and she was doing a show that she put together that were songs that she felt reflected her life. And it was lovely. We went there. We loved this place. We loved her. We hadn't seen her in years, and we knew there would be a lot of people there that we hadn't seen in a long time. That was a little intimidating to me. We went, and it was quite fine. People whom I'm Facebook friends with, but don't see, came up to me and said, I haven't seen you on Facebook very much lately. I said, yeah, I think I'm backing off a little bit to get some space. It's kind of intense what's going on. Another person said, I miss your voice. That was a bit hard. I mean, it was a blessing, right, that this person actually listened to my voice, but it was a little embarrassing that my pullback meant there was an absence that she was missing. And I was struck by that, and it got me back onto Facebook, I think, with some moderation. And Facebook actually is a community where I realize that I'm not alone. And so is Twitter. I realize there are people whose Twitter accounts I can follow. I can assure you there's one I don't. And John Dorar, the head of United Church of Christ, has a Twitter account, and if you have a Twitter account, I recommend you sign on, whatever you call that, what you call it on Twitter. Follow, thank you. Yes, technology. Follow him so you can see what's going on. It helped me kind of process the stuff that's going on in our country and has been going on in our country. And it helps me feel supported. However, when I check in with John Dorar's tweets, I have to not look at the responses. Because of his stature across the country, he attracts the haters, and it's hard. It's hard to look at. I am grateful to him that he's willing to put himself out there and continue to be out there. But it's that part, this is where I'm trying to learn that discipline, the how can I be out there without being so far out there that I'm not taking care of myself. I need to be able to stand here on a Sunday morning. I need to be able to do donuts on a Saturday morning. I need to be able to sit with staff, lay members, and sort of planning. I need to be able to do those things. And if I let myself be overcome by what's out there, I can't do it. At least not the way I would like to do that. So the short story this week continued. And I did donuts, and my partner was Jeff Peterson. Jeff's a great, so my job, when I do donuts, the job I sign up for intentionally is second tray person. Not first tray person. I don't want to be next to the fryer. I don't want to have to move that big thing over. I can't do that. I want to be tray person too. I've checked out almost all the jobs in donuts, and this is the one I wanted to do. And Jeff was my partner. So one of the questions Jeff had for me was, so will there be any theological reflection on the eclipse? Like, I've got enough to deal with, Jeff. So the eclipse glasses are my tip of the hat to that. Although I can't imagine that if the storytellers about the story of Joseph were wanting to deal in eclipses, there would have been an eclipse when Joseph was tossed into the pit. The theological reflection piece is that the darkening of the sky was viewed as God being angry with what was going on. I sometimes wonder how we can ever have light. I'm pretty sure God's paying attention, but God's not so angry with us that the light is turned off. So before I met with Jeff over the trays. So do you know what the tray job is?
Yes. You don't have to sort it out.
Oh, we don't have to sort. We just have to move them from the fry basket to the tray, to the cafeteria trays, and then go out to the people who are cooking and sort it. Yeah, no. No, our job is pretty simple and pretty routine. I did get burned. Yeah, that's what I thought. But as soon as I showed up, and I'd like to get there a few minutes early so I can high-five the wonderful people from Pilgrim who are working, Sally Olson came up to me. I think you were captaining at that. No, someone else was. Oh, who was captaining?
I was.
Neil was captaining, okay. But Sally was the carrier of the tidings. You know what's going on out in the world, right? You know that there are nationalist white supremacists marching under the banner of freedom of speech. And a person was killed in Charlottesville last weekend. This weekend, on yesterday, there was another march by the alt-right in Boston, and beginning on, I think it was Thursday, on John Doerr's Facebook page and Twitter feed, he was talking about preparations for Boston. People gathered in Boston, people prepared in Boston to be a peaceful, prayerful presence in the midst of hate. And I've seen different numbers. I know that something way under 1,000 people from the alt-right were present in Boston, and something in the realm of 15,000 to 20,000 counter-protesters marched peacefully in Boston to say this is not going to be. Part of what we are trying to do is shine light where light needs to be shined. The reason Sally called me over is that one of our bathrooms was vandalized. And she showed me the vandalism. We don't know who did it, but someone thought that it was okay on one of our signs to use the N-word. Yes, here in Oak Park. It could be someone from outside Oak Park, but I do know that those of you who are people of color and have been in Oak Park would not be surprised that it might be from Oak Park. We cannot pretend this doesn't exist, and we have to shine a light on it. We have to say no more. We have to say, this is not okay. This is how our story evolves. We are not quiet. We will not sit down. We will stand up and we will do what is right, whatever that might be. For me, it's speaking, sometimes marching. Tomorrow night, the council will meet, and this, of course, will be on the agenda so that we can have a thoughtful response, just as we have had a thoughtful response in other times. Joseph grew in this story. He grew from a young, irresponsible, outrageous, narcissistic, self-centered fool into someone who was able and willing to embrace his family who had treated him poorly and forgive them. I need you to hear that while forgiveness is important, that each of us is able to forgive, I also want you to hear that it is crucially important that you do not forgive and open yourself to hurt. We cannot put out hate with hate. We can only put out hate with love, but it has to start with love of self. This text and other texts like it should never be interpreted to mean that you should be mistreated, that you should be abused, that you should be disrespected, that you should be treated anything less than equal. No, that is not what this text is about. It means that we together, our faith community, and we together stand up, and we together speak. Light will shine, and they will not put it out. Amen.